Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Laura Vogt, and I'm the curator of education here at your National World War I Museum and Memorial, right here in the heart of Kansas City, Missouri, where it has been since 1926. Now, it is my absolute pleasure to be welcoming you all here for what is to be an extraordinary evening with some extraordinary speakers. And it is equally a pleasure to be hosting this event because of an exhibition that we have the opportunity to share with you all, John Singer Sargent Gassed. It remains as moving and meaningful to our audiences today as it did almost 100 years ago. Now, we opened this exhibition, which is actually showing the painting of John Singer Sargent's Gassed, which is on loan to us from the Imperial War Museums in London. We are showing this oil painting and the further exhibition through June 3rd, and I would encourage you all to see it. It is truly moving and inspiring. We look at both the art and Sargent's experiences and what inspired him to create this monumental piece, and we also look at the human endeavor to continue to protect and detect against chemical weapons. And we tell that story through to today. And now, how many of you here in our audience have already seen John Singer Sargent Gassed? Fabulous. That means, and I am, I've got eyeballs on those of you who didn't raise your hands. means you still have some time, but I think you guys will agree that this is really spectacular. Please do see it. If you've seen it already, it will help somewhat with our evening as well, because it's going to resonate with those themes. Tonight, we're going to host three speakers in a rapid fire or TED Talk style event. As such, if you're one of the folks who joins us regularly, you'll notice that our Q&A mics are not where they normally are. That's because this evening we're not going to be doing question and answer. But I believe that our speakers, Dr. Dean Gray, David Carson, and Captain Tim Hornik, would be happy to answer questions in the auditorium lobby afterwards if you're able to catch them. Now, by the way, it's also a really great time if you have one of these, right, to go ahead and pull it out and turn that to silent. And while you're doing that, I'll tell you about an upcoming event that we have on April 10th, Protection and Detection, Chemical Warfare. You can join us for another spectacular discussion. It's going to be on the complex issues of chemical warfare and detection in the 21st century, featuring former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and retired General Richard Myers, Dr. Tom Sack, president and CEO of MRIGlobal, and Dr. Ron Truen of the National Bio and Agro Defense Facility at Kansas State University. You all, normally I work in history, and being able to talk with all of these science folks has been eye-opening for me in the last few months. Dr. Truen was sharing some information about just his everyday life, about things that are currently going on in Afghanistan and livestock and farming that was extraordinary and was the type of thing that I'm telling people about when I'm going to get coffee. I promise it is going to be great coffee talk and water cooler talk for you as well, so add April 10 into your calendar. Tonight, our speakers are going to be addressing the themes of John Singer Sargent's Gassed, each in their own area of expertise and each in their own way. And it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's first speaker, who I also have to admit, if ever there was a man who has a title that makes you think in true life he's Batman or a superhero, it is the gentleman who I'm just about to introduce. Now, Unleashed is a new terror in World War I, gas being used as a chemical weapon. Determination and ingenuity led to the detection of and protection against this weapon. Now, the horror of chemical warfare fostered in 1915, some of that still remains today, as does the human endeavor and advancement to counter it. Wrap too many pages. Dr. Dean Gray, he is the director of the Intelligence, Surveillance, and Reconnaissance Division at MRIGlobal and is responsible for its largest portfolio of programs in national security and defense. Dean oversees the Institute's detection and protection research conducted with chemical agents and directed the Defense Threat Reduction Agency's first Ebola virus eradication efforts in West Africa. Working with the Department of State, he was instrumental in developing a first-of-its-kind commercial aircraft compatible human transport unit, which allows medical staff to care for contagious patients as they transit them around the globe. Whether or not he's actually Batman, it's pretty superhero stuff that he gets to do. Would you please join me in welcoming Dr. Dean Gray?
Thank you, everyone. Laura, thanks for the introduction, and I appreciate everybody coming out tonight, especially on a rainy, kind of a chilly Wednesday. I want to spend the first couple of minutes of this presentation putting you all in this person's shoes. It's Syria, it's 2013. You're about 10 kilometers outside of Damascus. There's been an event of some sort. You don't know exactly what it was the week before. It may have been sarin. It was certainly a chemical weapon of some sort. And you've been dispatched here into this laboratory or this makeshift laboratory. And look around. The building is recently abandoned. You've got a dirt floor. You have a laboratory bench that looks like it was pulled out of somewhere else and haphazardly set up. The glassware on the laboratory bench is either unlabeled or it's labeled in a language that you can't read. You've got a lot of protective gear on, bulky boots, bulky gloves. You've got a respirator, full face mask, and it's hot. Your responsibility when you walk into this location is to collect samples. That's why you were sent there. You're going to collect because collection and analysis right now is still the only way and the best way to be able to determine forensic value of chemicals that are found in the field. All right, so looking at these pictures, what kind of thoughts or questions end up going through your mind when you see these? Maybe, is our team safe? All right, so you walked in with protective equipment on, are you safe? Do you have what you need attached correctly with what you're looking at to be able to do your job and finish your mission? What about what is it? You don't know what it is. You don't have any idea what it is. But that's what you're there to be able to collect so you can find out. And the third question that we'll investigate tonight is what does it mean? And that's the chemical intelligence part of it. What does it mean? What are the ramifications, the decisions that are made after you find out what it is? What happens? Is it a diplomatic response? Is it a military kinetic response? Or is it something else? Those aren't decisions that we end up making, but you don't make them without this kind of intelligence. So these essential questions, we're going to look at these in three different parts. The first one being challenges, some progress that we've made in this area, and then a future view at the end. This is a chemical intelligence cycle. And it's a cycle because once it finishes, it starts over again. And we're going to go through it because these are the steps that occur at a high level when you find something in the field after an event until you get results. And it always starts with an event. Something has happened. Something has caused you to go to that location that I just showed you. You were sent there because there was an explosion. You were sent there because there was a clandestine laboratory that was found that looked dangerous. You were sent there because people were injured the week before and now they're exhibiting some sort of physiological response that may have been in response to a chemical agent. You don't know, but there's an event. Something has happened, and you're sent to respond. You have to sample. You have to go in protective equipment, collect samples, and then take them back to an operating base. And this is really where the timeline draws out All right, this is where the time starts ticking. Sending your samples. If you are overseas and you don't have any of these capabilities on site, then you have to send them somewhere else. You've got to send them back here. They have to come to MRIGlobal. They've got to go to a government laboratory. They have to go somewhere. But it's always going to be a laboratory. That laboratory, once it gets finished with a deep forensic analysis of the samples, is then going to report those results. Then decisions can be made. It will at least help decisions to be made that have to do with chemical intelligence. Here's the challenge. The duration with this type of cycle, in a lot of cases, can last anywhere from weeks or months. And as our customers tell us, if something ends up taking months, it's not intelligence anymore. It's part of the historic record, which is still important, especially considering where we are tonight, right? But this has to do with intelligence and rapid decision making. So the analytical laboratory, and this is right down the street. I mean, this is at MRIGlobal, where we work, and these are a few of our staff members that have really devoted their careers to analysis of these types of materials. And chemical analysis in a high-fidelity laboratory with state-of-the-art equipment, it's required. There's no way around this in order to get chemical forensic intelligence from samples. And it's in-depth analysis. If we think about what's happened recently with the Novichok that was found in England, the news cycle still took days to be able to determine that it wasn't VX and that it actually was Novichok, and trying to attribute that to the Russian government. That event, that attempted assassination of a previous spy and his daughter, that was only miles from Porton Down. Porton Down is one of the premier laboratories in the world for this kind of analysis, and it still took days to be able to get that answer back to the media and hopefully to the people that can make decisions. And the analysis on those materials are still going on. You can't be Theresa May and stand up in front of Parliament and then also make a declaration against Russia at a 90% or maybe an 85% solution on what you think this is. It wasn't just a type of nerve agent. They said it was this nerve agent, which was Novichok, which was attributed back to the Russian government. That takes this type of analysis. It's very in-depth, and it takes subject matter experts, a couple of which we've got in the room tonight. Very, very intense analysis. Real time, however, from our customers is always desired. It takes some time, but real time is what they want. They want the answer right now so that it's not history, that it actually is intelligence. We're always asking ourselves then, how can we end up taking this timeline, that chemical cycle that I showed, and then reducing it? What can we do to gain efficiencies and try to chop some of that time off so that we make sure that we can respond for our customers faster without hindering any quality of the sample analysis? So back to our chemical intelligence cycle, what we started doing about over 10 years ago is chopping out that portion that has to do with sending samples out. And we were one of the first groups to do this with our customers. And you take mobile laboratories and they are put right alongside on base in a field forward operating position. So you're taking all of these with the samples received, the analysis and the confirmation, reporting of the results, and they're all on site. So just like having a Porton Down that would be a couple of miles away from an event, this would be a laboratory, a high fidelity laboratory that's present at an operating base. This is field forward chemical intelligence. You're taking this chemical intelligence and you're putting it forward in the field to provide that information for protection and for detection where it's needed the most, right? With the people that are in harm's way. I'm going to take you to West Africa now. This is Sierra Leone, and this was not in response to a chemical weapons attack. It was in response to the Ebola eradication efforts for the Department of Defense. And these are our laboratories in Sierra Leone, and our engineers on site were able to set these up, get them running within 7 days of arriving on site, in the middle of nowhere, truly. and then be able to set up with their own power and have them running and decreasing the amount of time for analysis that was taking previously from weeks to days, and in some cases even hours. And it was really a heroic effort. So led by the Department of Defense and some really brave people that we have on staff to be able to go into country and be able to get this type of work done, provide rapid diagnostics almost in real time so that people would know if they were actually carrying the Ebola virus or if they were not, because the treatment ends up being very different. This led to the eradication efforts that ended up finalizing in 2016. It was a great effort, really great effort. We're proud of that work. The outsides of these laboratories, we want them to look like this. That's the idea. We want them to be nondescript. They need to be rugged. They need to be ready to drop anywhere in the world, set up power to them, and then start providing intelligence on site, whether it's biological or whether, in this case, whether it's chemical. We want them to look like shipping containers. And then when you open the backs of them, that's where the high fidelity deep forensic analysis, the equipment that's essential to be able to provide these types of answers in the field, are located. There are different form factors that we end up working with, most recently also tent systems, which are, I mean, they're excellent for what they, for what their purpose is, which is to set them up and have them running in about 24 hours. That's what their purpose is. So even faster, drop them anywhere in the world to be able to provide infrastructure, regardless of what they look like on the outside, aside from being nondescript, the inside always contains all of the essential pieces of equipment that are necessary for the deep forensic analyses. That's what they have. So that's taking Porton down, or that's taking MRIGlobal headquarters or other government laboratories, ruggedizing them, shrinking them down, and deploying them and putting them where our people are in harm's way to provide them intelligence in the field. Now, future view. And this is a little bit of where the technology is going and some other things that we're working on down the road at MRIGlobal. We've gained a lot of efficiencies in this cycle with mobile laboratories, with being able to shorten that timeline. What we see happening with our customers now and what we're participating in is advancing from collection and analysis to sensor systems. It's not going to completely replace collecting and analyzing anytime soon, because this is a tremendously heavy, heavy lift to move all of this from collection and analysis to sensing, to sensor systems. I mean, does anybody have like an Apple Watch, Garmin, Fitbit? Anybody in the audience? Yeah, so you've got sensors, I do too. So you've got sensors that are telling you, you know, not just the time of a traditional watch, but, you know, your exercise regime, you've got the temperature, you've got my heart rate variability, all of these things. What they're doing, though, these sensors, and we're surrounded by them every day of our lives, they're providing us information in real time about things that we care about. That's where chemical analysis, chemical weapons in the field, is going to, moving from collecting and analyzing to sensors and taking distributed networked sensors that are going to be present in the environment, either on autonomous vehicles, on military vehicles, on uniforms, you name it, but providing an early warning. The idea with this type of sensor system is that you get ahead of the event. Can you predict? And if you can predict, maybe you can prevent. So you're not just strictly responding, you're actually doing something before the event occurs. That's the goal for this. And we've got several customers that we work with in this area, all in the Department of Defense and some other areas. One in particular that I'll mention, because it's just really interesting to think about the future of detection systems, is DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. Now, DARPA has started working again on this project to be able to turn plants that are going to be naturally in the environment into chemical detectors. So using a biological organism that may end up changing colors slightly in real time to be able to determine if some of the precursor chemicals that are present in chemical weapons are actually around in the environment at a really low detection level. It sounds kind of like science fiction. It's absolutely not. I mean, these are proposals that are going in right now, and we're really proud to be working with some of these groups on their really advanced sensor needs. They're dedicated to pushing this technology forward along with us. At any point in time, at MRI Global, we've got around, I don't know, two dozen or more projects that are going on with these types of customers in these areas and some other ones. Certainly in the mobile laboratory space, also outfitting military vehicles, evaluation of new chemical sensor systems that are going to be handheld but also part of new personal protective equipment, advanced wearable technologies for the warfighter, testing new protective equipment, and advanced training simulations. So back to the beginning, that was a training simulation that was actually taking place in Nevada, all right? And that's just part of a portfolio of things that we end up helping with protection and prevention of these materials. What we want to do with sensor technologies and these advanced projects is get to the stage of prediction rather than strictly reacting. And by doing that, not just moving the technology forward, but you end up helping to save lives. And that's part of our goal. It's part of the mission of MRI Global and the challenging problems and the smart solutions. And I've got to say that I'm really very proud of our mission. And as I look out in the audience tonight, I see several people from MRI Global that have helped make this presentation and what I'm presenting tonight possible. And it wouldn't be possible without their efforts. Thank you all for coming out tonight and listening. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Dr. Dean Gray, and thank you all who are part of that work. It really is incredible. John Singer Sargent was in Austria in 1914 when the war broke out, and as an American, he was an expat who lived in Britain at the time. He was not particularly keen to be involved. It actually wasn't until 1918, until he had a personal loss of his niece because of the war, that he decided to take on a project for the British government to create a work on Anglo-American cooperation. And after a month on the Western Front, Sargent found his inspiration. On August 21st, at a dressing station, which doesn't look at all like what Dr. Gray was just showing, but it was there that it was a French village that he saw these British soldiers who had been temporarily blinded by a mustard gas attack. Now, in the history field, we talk about this concept. It's a concept of public memory. It's the things that we remember, but we didn't actually experience, right? If you've seen Steven Spielberg movies, they've likely influenced your understanding of World War II. It is the art that's created, the movies we watch, the photographs we see that become our personal interaction with history. Speaker, oh, thanks so much for that. And you guys can really see it up close now. Our next speaker is David Carson, an award-winning photographer who spent time both in Iraq and Afghanistan. He is also a Pulitzer Prize-winning photographer for the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. His images were featured extensively in the 2015 Pulitzer Prize for Breaking News Photography, which included his coverage of the Ferguson protests. With that, I am also going to say that I think a few of the images and sounds are mature, but all things that have been shown in a newspaper. Be aware that anytime that we're talking about how should we and how do we capture images of violence, some of that is difficult to see and also expertly captured. Because though we don't experience that, it is that human experience that we need to be able to engage with within our community. And David Carson is one of those who helps tell that story. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome David Carson.
So in February, I got a call from Laura at the World War I Museum, and she wanted to know if I'd be interested in making this presentation tonight. And she said, you know, she talked about my experiences covering the wars as a war correspondent, and I was like, I don't really know if I'm a war correspondent. I'd spent a month in Iraq in 2004 and a month in Afghanistan in 2006, but I think to call myself a war correspondent cheapens what real war correspondents do who are over there for years at a time and stuff. But I didn't want to tell her no, and I'd been recommended by a friend of hers, and I didn't want to let this friend down. And so I said, why don't you send me an email about the event summarizing it and let me think about it. And so she sent me this brief summary, and I needed her to send me that summary because I'm an idiot, I also had to go and Google this painting because I wasn't familiar with it. So I went and I looked at it, and the next day I read Laura's email and it all clicked for me. Her note mentioned I'd be qualified because I was an observer of violent history. That line, an observer of violent history, struck me because sadly, yes, I've been an observer of a lot of death and violence. But more sadly, most of this death and violence that I've witnessed during my career has been within 15 miles of my front door. This is a photo from a double shooting a few blocks from my office. The woman is comforting her nephew who's been shot twice in the torso. There's another man lying about 100 feet away from him, and he's been shot once in the leg. I arrived at this scene before both the police and the ambulance. This is a photo from a volatile protest where hours earlier police had shot and killed a teenage boy during a drug raid on a house. The police said the teenage boy had a gun and pointed it at them. The protester said he was unarmed. This is from some of the Ferguson protests. This man had driven through a line of protesters and got stopped a ways up the street, and the protesters were surrounding his car, and he pulled out a gun. We were moments away from shots being fired, and fortunately, it didn't go that way. I go to scenes like this on a weekly basis. Shot up cars, drive by. This is at a convenience store. This woman's just walking down to the convenience store to pick up some milk. Bullet scarred window. This is the scene of a triple shooting in a St. Louis suburb. And the woman in the center of this frame is the mother of one of the homicide victims, and she's pleading with the police officer to let her go see her son. And the police officer, later said to me that he just tears his heart out when this happens. And this is a memorial for a homicide victim who was killed and robbed of his car while he was trying to sell it on Craigslist. So yes, in my job as a newspaper photojournalist, I've witnessed a lot of violence. Now, with that last series of photos I showed you, it paints a really negative, depressing photo or image of the city I've lived in for the past 18 years. And if those images were the only thing I ever photographed, I'd be doing the readers of the Post-Dispatch a disservice, because there's a lot of great people and places and things in St. Louis, like the Arch. And, there's happiness and there's joy. This is a coach who's won his 100th basketball game. And this is from a festival here in town. And we have the Arch. And this is from Forest Park, a beautiful urban park in St. Louis that St. Louisans like to brag about being bigger than Central Park. And we have the Cardinals. And unfortunately, the Cubs have been on the winning edge lately. And we have the Arch. but seriously, if you've not been to the Arch in the last few years, you want to go back starting this summer. They're just completing a $380 million renovation of the Arch, and so it's really gorgeous. But gun violence is a serious problem in St. Louis, and so as a journalist, I'm going to continue to cover the issues that are affecting the quality of life of where I live. As I researched Sargent's painting some more, I began to see similarities between his painting and the things that I attempted to show in my work. Sargent put a little scene, let's see, where's that pointer? There it is. Sargent put this little scene up here of these guys playing soccer in the back of the photo. I don't know if you've seen the photo, I overlooked it, but there's this scene of tragedy, and Sargent has painted in these guys playing soccer. So, it's ordinary life taking, playing contrast to the tragedy that's unfolding. And this is a theme that I regularly try to visit in my work. So this was 2015, and I'm at a high school football game. It's just an average Friday night football game. And about halftime, I'm staying on the sidelines. I'm talking to one of the security guards over there. And in the distance, you can hear some gunshots, bang, bang, bang. And I said, you can't do anything in this city without hearing gunshots. And then the gunshots started to get closer and closer and louder. Bang, bang. And people started running and screaming, bang. Two cars went by the road right next to the field, firing shots at each other. Bang, bang, bang. This mother's calling out to one of her children who's a distance away from her, and she's using her body to shield her four-year-old child from the bullets. The cheerleader in the background is screaming as she falls to the ground. The gunfire was so close this night that you could smell the gunpowder in the air. So the cars pass, and the gunfire fades off into the distance, and people began getting up. And the coaches and the referees met, and they decided to continue the game. No one had been struck by gunfire at the field, fortunately. This is just a part of city life. Gunfire on a Friday night is just expected. About a mile away, police found a man slumped over the wheel of his car who had been shot. Daily life in St. Louis, it's rare to go a day without someone being shot. This little girl was on her way home from school when she walked past that fatal shooting scene. To her right, family members are grieving and screaming. This is another shooting scene months later. This kid's walking to school, and police are gathering blood trail evidence from a shooting that happened the night before. So he's just walking to school, and it looks a little weird because he's got his arms tucked into his coat because he's a kid, and that's the way, kids walk around. But his innocence of, sitting there with his, arms tucked in and just being a kid, contrasted off of these cops who are collecting blood trail evidence from a crime scene. It's like, this is what he walks by on his way to school. How does he process that when he gets to class? Like Sargent's painting of tragedy, these sad scenes can also be beautiful. I love this photo, and I hate this photo. It's beautiful, but it makes me so sad. These balloons were released by elementary school students whose 11-year-old classmate was killed by a stray bullet. And these were his classmates after they released the balloons. And so often, the gun violence in the city is affecting kids. I spend far too much time at these scenes. This was last summer in St. Louis. A baby, a two-year-old, was just hanging out inside the homicide crime scene tape. It was the third homicide in a month that had happened within 100 yards of this boy's front door. I wanted to know more about this kid, but I couldn't get close enough to talk with him or his mother, who's actually sitting on the steps of his front house just to the left. But there's bullet casings around there, and they got the two-year-old running around it. And this was just around the corner from his house where the guy had run and fallen and died. And then all the neighborhood's out, and they're looking and gathering. And the police are gathering and looking at evidence. And then this was sort of unusual. The shooter from the scene came back and confessed to shooting the guy because he said it was self-defense. So they took him into custody there, and they recovered the gun out of the car. So I was fascinated with the scene, and so oftentimes I'm into a scene and I leave and I never come back to it, but I was really drawn back to the scene. So the next day I went back to the scene, and this was a picture of just daily life going on around the corner from where the shooting had taken place. I wanted to know more about who this kid was, who were the people who lived there, and what are their stories. And so it took me a few days and multiple trips back, but I finally got connected with the mom, Donna Green. This is her in the doorway, and Donovan. And she has an interesting story. She's a single mom who lives in public housing. She gets up before 5 a.m. every day so she can take a bus to bring her two kids to daycare, and then takes another bus to her minimum wage job at McDonald's. She doesn't want to live where three fatal shootings have happened in less than a month, right outside her front door. But she doesn't really have a lot of choices. Here she's letting her kids catch a few more minutes of sleep before they have to run and catch the bus. And then she hustles them out the front door. This is 5:30 in the morning, and mom's carrying the kids out to the bus stop so she can get them to daycare, so she can get to her minimum wage job. And part of my job as a news photographer is to make the comfortable uncomfortable. I want people in the suburbs that have comfortable lives to see what the challenges are of their neighbors that live in the city. And so I do these stories, and I want people to see these stories, and I want people to know that, you know, life may be great and easy for you, but there's other challenges going on in our community. Coming back to Sargent's painting, I think it's important to talk about the pace at which he worked and the pace at which information moved in 1918. Sargent went to the Western Front in July of 1918. He did some sketches there, but he didn't finish his painting until March of 1919. Everything in his paintings is perfect. He intentionally puts every brushstroke there, includes the soccer players on purpose, includes the hand positioning, the line of soldiers, every brushstroke, it's all perfect. It's exactly the way he wants it, and he's thought about it and planned it out. My work happens in fractions of a second, moments that flash by, sometimes unseen until they're frozen by the camera. This picture is actually from Ferguson. This is of a St. Louis County tactical team member firing tear gas, and I have a video from later in the presentation we can reference back to here. Sargent's work as a painter was slow and deliberate. And my work is often live streamed, tweeted, and posted online before the events are even finished. Sargent's work unfolded over months. In mine, I'm busy uploading photos to my phone and tweeting them out. This is a photo of live streamers this is a photo of protesters who are live streaming a cop with his phone, as he also shoots a GoPro video of them, while the cop uses his phone to film video of them. So, you know, it's fascinating the speed at which this stuff happens now. And as I researched more into Sargent's painting, something very obviously came up to me. I was like, duh, I didn't think about this before. I began to identify with Sargent's paintings, painting gas, because during my time covering the protests in Ferguson, there were days after days after days of being tear gassed. And that's me at the center of the frame here with a helmet on. And I'm just gonna play this video. This will give you an idea. This was the third consecutive night of gas.
Please continue to share this link on social media.
This is not video that I shot. This was, because obviously I'm in it.
Now the line is advancing rapidly. Here they come. Share this link. Let the world see. The line is advancing onto the crowd. Here come the police. The line is standing. The crowd is peacefully standing with their hands in the air.
The high-pitched sound is a sonic crowd dispersal device the police are using.
Here comes the St. Louis County Police Department continuing to advance their line. We have now pulled back a city block and a half. There it goes. They're now firing onto the crowd. Out! Shit! They're firing rubber bullets. For a second time, violence has erupted in the city of Ferguson. They are firing rubber bullets and smoke grenades. Arrested. Now they are firing them into the neighborhoods, into the back of people's houses. We will continue to broadcast. Oh, gas mask tomorrow.
So it's funny, it's funny because while this is happening, you know, you laugh about it afterwards and stuff. But while it was going on, it was terrifying. This was the photo I made from that night. This was one of our photos that was included within our Pulitzer Prize entry. This particular guy had run up and picked up a tear gas canister and thrown it back at the police who had fired it. It's funny, like this picture really resounded. It was on the front page of the Wall Street Journal and several other publications. The next day, someone told me, "I'm going to wreck this photo for you," because they wrecked it for me. You see the dragon in the photo? It's just a coincidence, but someone said, "Do you see the dragon?" I'm like, "Thanks, now you wrecked it for me." But this is how I would go dressed. And I spent, one of the things I'm most proud about my coverage there in Ferguson is I spent nights covering the protests, staying side by side with the protesters as they were being shot at with rubber bullets and tear gassed and pepper sprayed. And I also spent nights being embedded with the St. Louis County Tactical Team, which is on the left over here. I wore a little bit different dress. I would wear a level 4 vest over here and a level 3 vest over there. I think that I went out of my way to be fair to both sides doing it, and I think that that is what helped separate our coverage. So I'm going to play another video here. This one's about 2 minutes, I think. And this is from the night that I'm embedded with the Ferguson, or with the St. Louis County Tactical Team. That picture we made, the picture I showed earlier where the guy was firing the tear gas, this is from that night. So let's see.
If we fire gas, you're going to take this section back. We're going to take the middle section. The other state guys are taking the quick trip lot. So if you want to start here, work your way back, that's fine. We're going to take this side of quick trip towards the auto shop. What do you say? I can't hear. Why don't we just point it? As soon as we say it one more time, you'll know it. That's what, trust me.
You'll hear some gunshots here, and that's going to be a demarcation point in the video.
Shots fired, shots fired.
You don't actually hear shots. So this is an American street, and it looks worse than anything I'd been experienced in Iraq or Afghanistan. And where they're firing the tear gas from, that's where the shots came from, that's where the gunshots came from. So I never thought I'd have an opinion about which was worse, tear gas or pepper spray, but given the choice, I'll take tear gas. And this is all tear gas in this photo. These photos, they can be beautiful, but the reality is, you know, if you fired tear gas like this in Iraq or Afghanistan, it would be a war crime because it's banned under the Geneva Convention. That's why his work is so important.
you know, to so we can build evidence to, you know, prosecute these war criminals for firing gas on civilians. This is my coworker, Coran, and Coran got too close to a protest we were covering. And this is the protest. It's inside and outside the St. Louis Police Department. The protesters were trying to occupy the St. Louis Police Department. Both he and I got too close. You'll see why. So the police are just trying to push them out the front door of the apartment, and then some pepper spray comes out. That's me being pepper sprayed. That's not my story. So I'm just about running out of time here, but that, you know, in that scene, you know, where I'm getting pepper sprayed and stuff, that's where I developed my preference for tear gas. And the reason for that is that pepper spray is the gift that keeps giving. You will sweat. It's an oil that gets into your eyes. And hours later, you'll get another dose of it and stuff. I came home from work that day, and my daughter, who's sitting right up front here, was there. And she goes, "Daddy," and she tries to give me a hug. I'm like, "Get away from me. Don't touch me." And because I had to go and wash my clothes, and I actually did not want to, I had to figure out what I was going to do with my clothes, because I didn't really want to wash my clothes in my own laundry machine, because it had all this pepper spray on it and stuff. But, you know, we ended up just doing a few clean cycles on it, but it worked out. Anyways, thanks for listening to me. If you have questions afterwards, just find me. I'm happy to talk about it. Thank you.
Now, if you want to see some of the images of other folks who were embedded in World War I, you can join us downstairs in the Ellis Gallery in May. We've got a new exhibition that is coming out. It is called War Around Us, Soldier Artist Impressions. And also, if some of those images of violence in the community, that strikes you, do you know that communities around our nation, around the world, are all struggling with these things? And right here in Kansas City, we will be hosting on May 22nd a really fantastic conversation called One Community, bringing everyone together to be talking about how here in Kansas City we can be addressing some of those issues. So pay attention to our upcoming events where more information on that will be hosted. Now, David said that he wanted his images to resonate, to leave people who were not aware, who hadn't experienced that, to be uncomfortable. And John Singer Sargent, in many ways, was exactly the same. If you recall from the earlier introduction, he was given a project by the British government to create an image on Anglo-American cooperation. But what he created is certainly not that. He wanted to share with us and share with those of that time the images that he saw, that he was moved by, of those who have served, of those who did not receive enough protection from the weapons that were aimed at them. And also that human spirit, that hope remains. Life does go on. You've got our soccer players in the back. But also, and you all may have been experiencing the Mr. Rogers anniversary as well, what Mr. Rogers said, always look for the helper in the images. Though that happens 50 years before that, you can see right here in this image, in the far right hand in the back, you can see the medics, you see the healers embracing, leading, and helping these servicemen. Now, when I first met our next speaker, we were actually talking about a completely different event that we are looking forward to hosting in the fall. And he started describing to me this image that we have as our public memory. When we think of wounded veterans as a community, we think of this painting of wounded soldiers who have been blinded, walking in a line. Now, here's the thing. I hadn't actually told this gentleman that we were going to be getting John Singer Sargent's guest. So in that moment, that's a really great moment for me as a curator of education. Our next speaker is Captain Tim Hornik. He is the Vice President of the Heartland Regional Blinded Veterans Association and a medically retired Army officer. As the founder of Blind Not Alone, he provides training, advocacy, and education on technologies for individuals with visual impairments. He is currently pursuing his PhD in therapeutic sciences through the University of Kansas Medical Center's Occupational Therapy Education, investigating adaptive sporting and recreational programs for disabled veterans. Through his work, Tim advocates, educates, and assists fellow veterans and their families to cope with and overcome the barriers created by disabilities. Please join me in welcoming Captain Tim Hornik.
There we go. Okay. Well, I just want to say thank you guys very much for coming and joining us. I'm not going to have any flashy types of pictures like Dave and Dean did. I'm just going to rely on this 100-year-old painting as my backdrop, because it is a central point on why it is that we are here today, what it is that we are looking at. And now I'm focusing in particular on how we go from this image 100 years ago to today in relationship to blindness and blind rehab amongst visually impaired veterans who have served. Now, another thing that Laura did not mention that also adds some pretty cool kudos points to this entire thing is today is National Blind Veterans Day. It's a holiday that started a couple years ago just to recognize all the sacrifices that veterans have done who have sustained a visual impairment either in the line of service or later on in their lives. And those items I will touch upon a little bit later, because it all starts here with that line of visually impaired veterans walking arm in shoulder, helping each other off the battlefield. Now let me tell you, blindness is horrific to go and experience right off the bat. And this is one of the things that we look at World War I and we say it's the war to end all wars. Yes, it was the war to end all wars. It ended warfare as we knew it, and it created the new modern warfare as it is fought today. It's not pretty, it's not clean, it doesn't have straight lines, it is messy, it is dysfunctional, it has a lot of different ways that it's going to injure you. However, as a positive over the last 100 years, what we have had is two things. One, we had increase in lethality of the munitions that are being used, but more importantly, we had a tremendous increase in the protection gear that we wear today, as well as medical treatments that we are able to receive that is making us go from being casualties of war to just individuals who have been injured. And that's where I'm just going to start today by just looking at the casualties of war going back over the last 100 years. So in World War I, we had about 1.9 million service members deployed into the European theater to fight in this trench warfare. During this, we had about 160,000 of those individuals die. Now let's compare this to Vietnam. Vietnam lasted about 11 years. And oh, by the way, tomorrow is National Vietnam Veterans Day, so extra plug. But in that 11 years, we had about 2.7 million service members that went and served within the Vietnam region, other neighboring countries in that area. What we also have is a dramatic decrease in number of casualties compared to World War I to Vietnam. we had about 47,000 of our fellow service members die in Vietnam. Now, let's look at warfare today. We have spent the last 17, 16 years fighting Iraq, Afghanistan, other Middle Eastern countries, Horn of Africa, and various other places around the world fighting terrorism. Now, during these conflicts, we have had at least 2.2 million, numbers probably a little bit greater than that, but we've had more multiple deployments than either in World War I and Vietnam. So who knows what's going to be the final count. Besides, we're still fighting there. Now, within these recent conflicts, we've had 6,868 deaths as of earlier this week. Now, if we look at that, that is a dramatic decrease. And statistics will call that there's an inverse relationship or inverse correlation between the number of deaths that we have and what I'm going to talk about next, which is visual impairments from these conflicts. Now, in World War I, we know about 2,100 or so veterans that sustain a traumatic visual impairment or blindness as a result of their service. In the recent conflicts, we have had over 202,000 service members sustain some form of ocular trauma. Now, I'm not saying blindness or visual impairment, just ocular. Your ocular system goes everywhere from the front part of your eye all the way to your visual cortex and everywhere in between. About 82% of those individuals had their injury sustained by IEDs and concussives. And you want to know what? There's a similarity between that and what happened in World War I. In World War I, there was about 75,000 individuals who were injured. Majority of those, roughly 74% or about 52,000 of those individuals, received their injuries as a result of shelling. About 28% received it due to small arms. So we see that between World War I and with our current conflicts, there is a pretty interesting relationship there that most of our injuries that we are seeing has to do with shelling, concussives, and other types of non-direct fire type of weapons. And how does this relate to visual impairments? Well, a lot. So if we look at the entire number of casualties we had in World War I, it was a tremendous number. A lot of those individuals had head injuries and suffered gas injuries and other types of injuries that today they might have lived. But back then, they didn't have a chance. Look at John Singer Sargent's painting. We had that line of soldiers marching off with the band-aids over their eyes, that cotton cloth covering their eyes after being gassed. I mean, that was first aid back then. We have a couple of service members that have patches over their heads. I mean, that's all they had back then. And so a lot of those individuals would have died shortly there afterwards or on their way to the field hospital. Whereas today, that's not the case. I'm the example of what happens when someone gets shot in the head by a sniper and walks off the battlefield. Very similar to what we see in this painting. What's the difference? I'm still here. Most of those individuals were not. Now, how did this all change? Well, the continuum of care, as medical researchers and providers would call it, that has dramatically changed. In World War I, what we had is a handful of field and general hospitals spread throughout Europe and the United States. And it would take roughly 36 hours to get from the trenches and the front lines to one of those hospitals. Today, we have both major medical military treatment facilities in Baghdad, Kabul, and other areas, as well as medics who have all the latest gear and technology necessary in order to save lives, providing life-sustaining treatment to stabilize those individuals within hours. That's a traumatic difference. Think, 36 hours versus a matter of hours. In my own case, I was getting put under anesthesia in the Baghdad Emergency Department International Zone within 15 minutes of being shot. That's pretty freaking amazing if you think about it. When, if you look at World War I now, yeah, 36 hours. Percent chance that I would have lived back then, as I said, probably very low. Why would I have died? Probably not from being shot right away, but definitely from secondary effects of having an infection or something else during that 36-hour trip. That would have probably done me in more than anything else. But here, hey, I was able to go and talk with my nurse, and she was like, hey, you're getting your IV now. Good night, and we'll see you in the morning. I was like, okay, let's get it on. Let's get the surgery going. Because, yes, I was fully awake and functional when all this happened. Now, let's look at the next phase of this continuity of care. So you're at the field station in World War I. Now you have to get to the general hospitals and stuff back in the United States. You're looking at a 2 to 3 week expedition across the seas. Now, who here likes traveling on cruises? Because you ain't going to have that boat back in World War I. You're going to have a very nice, rough, tossy-turny boat taking you from the front lines back to the United States. Most likely, you would have ended up at Fort McMurray, which is in Georgia, which was the central place for receiving individuals with eye and head traumas in World War I. Now, today, you receive most of that treatment that you would have in theater, or within 24 hours, which is the average time span it takes to get someone from point of injury in Iraq and Afghanistan, it's a long stool, 24 hours to Germany, wow, pretty impressive. You would have been receiving stabilizing care. If you were there for 3 days, you're probably going to be sent back to the United States, and you would have been back at home at whatever it takes to catch a red-eye military transport from Landstuhl into Walter Reed or Bethesda. And from there, your services would then commence with trying to figure out where you're going to go. If you're staying in Landstuhl for more than a couple days, up to 3 weeks, odds are you're going to go back to theater. Why? Because the surgeons there in Landstuhl in Iraq and Afghanistan were able to treat you so well that you could return to duty much quicker, which is why we don't have more blind guys like me walking around from the current conflicts. Why our number is only about 3,313 at the current moment of individuals who sustain a severe visual impairment or blindness, because that continuity of care is so different. Especially when we look at that 2,100 that had a visual impairment that we know of from World War I. Now, we do suspect, researchers, that is, do suspect that the numbers of individuals with visual impairments is much greater than that. We're just not too sure. Why is that? Because there was no longitudinal studies, or there was no continuity of care. There wasn't our social workers like we have today tracking us, keeping track of us. There wasn't the follow-up services to go and see if you are having any issues with your sight back then. What is suspected that for the 70,500 service members in World War I that sustained gas attack hospitalizations, that even though most of that was acute injuries to the eye from gas, as in cornea scarring, scarring of the lids and tear ducts and other external structures of your eye, that most of that did go away for the first couple of years, but there is evidence from ophthalmological records from the early 1930s that suggests that that is not the case, that by the early 1930s, a lot of those individuals were showing back up into the healthcare systems that were available at that time. Unfortunately, this is when I get to go and give you a little bit of bad news, is that the places like the Fort McMurray or the Evergreen General Hospital in Massachusetts that provided blind rehab for those service members, those were no longer there. By 1928, 1929, someone decided to shut down all of the services for the VA and go with the privatization option and said, hey, you're on your own. And whereas today, we have individuals that are still receiving these services and care years later. Good example are Vietnam veterans. Why am I going to point them out? Is because they are the fastest growing group of individuals with visual impairment amongst the veterans today. Why? Because we are knowing today the effects of Agent Orange. Agent Orange is a horrific chemical substance for veterans to have countered in Vietnam, because it's causing them lifelong health issues, a lot of them showing up not until a couple of years ago. One of these items is diabetes. What is a secondary condition of diabetes? Diabetic retinopathy, which is a visual impairment that leads to blindness because of diabetes. This is why our Vietnam veterans are now the fastest growing population of visually impaired veterans we have today. Now, if we would have known that back in World War I, that the gas that those service members experience, well, we might have kept around the Veterans Bureau a little bit longer. We might have kept around those facilities a lot longer than what we did in World War I and not shut them down in 1928 or so. So let's go ahead and jump over to the next part, where we're looking at how did all of this stuff come about? Well, the first group of individuals that did anything related to blind rehab occurred in 1915. And when Laura mentioned the Anglo-American relationship, here's where all this stuff really starts coming together on why this was an interest. Well, in 1915, Sir Arthur Pearson, a blind individual himself who was knighted, started the first blind rehabilitation center in London, serving only doughboys. from there, he created, or is known to be, the creator of the modern era blind rehabilitation system. In 1917, when the U.S. was looking for how to serve all those individuals from the U.S. that were blinded or suffering from visual impairments, we sent over a group of ophthalmologists and other researchers to ask Sir Arthur Pearson what it is that they were doing. How is it that we can we transplant that service from there here into the United States? And that is how we came up with Evergreen Hospital, which is also known as General Hospital Number 7 in Massachusetts. So that came about originally around May 2017. By November 15, 2017, Evergreen Hospital started to receive the first group of visually impaired veterans coming from the Western Front receiving blind rehabilitation services. Now, if you're wondering what those services look like, well, they were not anything like you would see or recognize today. They were very basic services focusing on employment and vocational skills like typewriting, dairy farming, poultry farming, vulcanization, massage, and just a couple of other options and not a whole lot else. There was no types of orientation mobility occurring yet at that time. That would not come up for a couple more decades. But that is all that was available at that time that we had for these veterans. That's why most of these individuals opted not to go to Evergreen. Most of them opted to go back home because that was comfortable for them. They weren't yet prepared to deal with blindness. So after they go and they got back, you know, for those that didn't go home, they went to the old soldiers' home, like the ones that we have up in Winchester or the ones that we have in, the other side of the state. Or by Hutchinson in Dodge City. You know, that's where they would have gone. That's why those places were set up. That's why they existed. And so that's where a lot of them would have went. And so by about 1917, 1918, when the Blind Rehab Center at Evergreen was set up and running at full steam, they were getting about 50 people at a time as inpatients receiving blind rehab care. And like any other war that you have, well, expect overcrowding populations in the hospital systems because there's a huge influx. So what they originally set up for 50 individuals was serving 100 individuals at a time in 1919. And at that point, the Red Cross was handling and managing those services. Now, around 1922, the Red Cross handed everything over at Evergreen to the Veterans Bureau, and then, as I just said, by about 1928, 1929, that ended. So what happened next? Well, World War II happened, and around 1942, the Secretary of Department of Education was worried that we had nothing set up for blind soldiers that would be going off to World War II. What was the concern? We were afraid that the Germans would fall back and use chemical warfare again. And since we had nothing set up, he raised the flag and said, we need something established. So by July 1942, 1943, President Roosevelt set forth a commission to go and start investigating what they need to do in order to establish blind rehab. How did he do that? Well, he sent over a group of individuals in 1943 to St. Dunstan's again in London to see what they were doing. What have they done over the last 30 years to improve their services? And from there is where we start seeing the first set of blind rehabilitation as we know it today. The forefathers of it, as we know, is an individual by the name of Tech Sergeant Warren Bledsoe and Lieutenant Hoover, who was a physical therapist. What did they develop? Well, how many people know that white cane technique that we see individuals who are blind using? Well, they developed that in 1943. That was not developed yet in World War I. That didn't come across until 1943, and that's just kind of the first tool that we have with the new paradigm for blind rehabilitation. Let's make individuals as independent as possible. And so after that, they set up the first blind rehabilitation center called Valley Forge. That was a War Department / Defense Department initiative. And the way that things went is those that were injured and sustained a visual impairment around 1944 would have been sent to Valley Forge. And that's where they received the first bit of blind rehabilitation training with using the cane. Now, this would eventually evolve and be transferred over to the Department of Veterans Affairs. In 1947, a group of advocates led by Father Thomas Carroll, the Blind Veterans Association, the American Foundation for the Blind, and several other individuals approached General Omar Bradley, who was in charge of the veterans at that point, and said, we need a central blind rehabilitation center here in the VA to continue the care because it's no longer a defense issue, it's a veterans issue. So with that, the Hines Blind Rehabilitation Center was erected in 1947 with the first group of individuals receiving care from Hines in 1948. Now, Hines is the center of the blind rehabilitation universe from around the world, not just in the VA and here in America. In fact, it's the blind rehabilitation center that serves all of us blind veterans here in the Heartland, throughout Kansas, Missouri, Iowa, Nebraska, you name it, throughout the entire Midwest. We all go to Hines still. Hines is fantastic, and it's what we rely on. We also rely on other services from the VA for care that did not exist back in World War I or even World War II, like our visual impairment services coordinator, who we have one of them sitting up here named Dawn. Just look for her up in the front row, sitting over by me, whose fantastic services allows us to regain our independence, to find that new aspect of life, to move forwards and regain our hope. Unlike the veterans that we see here marching out the fields who went back home and didn't have these services. And we have about 140 of these visual impairment service coordinators throughout the country. We have 13 blind rehabilitation centers as compared to the one that we had in World War I and the one or two that we had in World War II. We have 13 now serving the roughly 146,000 prospective visually impaired veterans that live today. And it just keeps going, getting better. Looking at the entire relationship between the US and the UK, this relationship still goes strong because it's from the relationship with St. Dunstan's and Veterans of the United States that we do have the services at Hines. The first director of the Hines Blind Rehab Center, as well as the first director of the blind rehab services within the VA, his name was Russell Williams. He was a veteran that was injured in the European theater that went blind, that went to St. Dunstan's for his initial blind rehabilitation training, and then he came back here to America and just revolutionized what it means to be both a blind veteran and receiving blind care. More recently, the Blind Veterans Association, as well as St. Dunstan's, which is now called Blind Veterans United Kingdom, started a project called Project Gemini that rekindles this in 2006. And what we have done is we have paired blinded veterans, blind rehabilitation specialists, ophthalmology researchers, people from our respective Veterans Affairs communities and other advocates to go and visit each other's campuses. What has happened from this? Aside from sharing of best practices, this program has allowed a lot of research to move forward. We have strengthened the partnership between Moorfields Eye Clinic, which is the leading Royal Military's ophthalmology service center, as well as research for the entire UK, with our own Walter Reed, our Vision Center of Excellence, which is a Department of Defense Center of Excellence looking at vision particularly, as well as researchers from ARVO to go and expand what we know about not just blindness, but research. How is it that we're not going to be able to just have individuals just go blind during service, but change it where we're able to restore it? It's from these relationships that we have been able to advance the knowledge base on how to diagnose and treat visual impairments related to traumatic brain injuries, which is a real thing that affects about 80% of individuals with a traumatic brain injury from the current conflicts and speculative all conflicts that have this. It's how we're developing things like eye transplant surgeries that is going on at the University of Pittsburgh right now, the same team that did the hand transplants, how we're looking at creating implants that could be implanted either in the front part of the eye or within your visual cortex to restore vision. It's how these types of partnerships with the UK, with our fellow NATO allies, with blinded veterans leading the way, saying we need to change this and here's some ways that we're going to do it. And it all starts by looking back at what happened 100 years ago when we came together as a community to solve an issue on let's get blinded veterans a chance to have a new life. So that's pretty much it for me.
As Tim said, though John Singer Sargent didn't know it, when he painted this, he truly did paint an image of what would become Anglo-American cooperation. Ladies and gentlemen, my speakers, thank you all so very much. It has been an honor to have you all on our stage and to share your story with those here in the audience and also with those out on the interwebs. If you want to share their story, direct folks to our website, www.theworldwar.org. And please be sure to come back and take a glimpse or another of John Singer Sargent's Ghast. And will you please join me in thanking Dean, Dave, and Tim. Thank you very much.